Western art was deconstructive, disruptive, and he brings up all these characters. He uses calligraphic scrolls in very vague ways around here, and he just surrounds this in a puddle of color. And that's why I think a lot of people who collect Tzu-Ping's words don't really like it, because they usually view it as part of this Chinese Nanyang tradition. But well, this is part of how he tried to abstractify characters, this sort of character strokes. And well, whether you like it or not, I think it's a personal taste. But what we gain from this exhibition, the idea that we get is that he has already begun to start to translate his ideas that characters and trees they are formed from the same strokes, they have the same aesthetic quality. He has already consciously tried to express this through his art. And we get paintings like this. And the sizes are very significant. You see, this is 275 by 480. I think that wall is about 480. So you get an idea of the hugeness of his new paintings. And there's this sort of dynamic character, this randomness, this use of color that was very different from his previous paintings. And in that exhibition, he also exhibited this piece, which again is his very favorite sort of subject matter. So, right after his success in creating this sort of image, I think he tried to recreate, to redo his newfound aesthetics within his familiar environment. I think this is a motif you'll continue to see. So, the story behind this exhibition is that Mr. Ko, having seen that Tze Peng has produced this very large body of imaginative works that transcended anything that broke free from what he used to do, held this exhibition in the SDPI, and I think this is the first touchstone for his new style. This is the first time the public will be seeing his new style. And the reaction to this exhibition was just lukewarm. And I think it's understandable, because if you imagine you are a Tze Peng collector, for 20 years you've been collecting works like this, and suddenly you are faced with works like that on the back, you wouldn't really know how to react to it. So there was a bit of confusion, and I think whenever an artist comes out with something really new, people ask if it's just a phase. Yeah. But I think it's his first step towards his new style, and despite his lukewarm response to this exhibition, I think it's aesthetically successful. And right after that, he started to have a very clear and distinct direction for himself. If you later look through this catalog, which has a lot at the back, the first thing that was striking is that it's extremely varied in style. If you take out a bit of the personal characteristics of his strokes, it's really quite hard to believe they're from the same artist. But after that exhibition, I think that he began to be very clear on his own aesthetic identity, something like this, which we have now become quite familiar with. So he took the subject matter that he chose was, of course, the trees, and the central philosophy was what he has always believed in, that the abstracted beauty of the roots and of the calligraphic practice that he loved so much was really the same thing. And well, we have seen before that he attempted to do it in a quite direct way. I think he has developed on that idea, and try to make it more less distinct, more vague, and more slightly more direct, more interestingness towards his expression of this idea. And this is a quote from him, which gives you an idea of his central aesthetic philosophy that I have heard in interviews since the 70s, but I think only really begin to be shown now. And yeah, it works like this. In some works, there's a direct comparison between characters and the trees, which you don't get in this, but you'll get in this. This is from 2006, but this sort of works, he continued to produce them in 2008. So you see there are characters here, and there's the tree here. But I think what he's trying to do is providing you with a visual clue. It's like, when you look at it, you're saying, wait, this is not just games, this is actually a piece of calligraphy. And then you start to wonder whether this is actually calligraphy or not. And also the space, this sort of color, it's not just colors, they're actually executed in calligraphic scripts. So by this sort of visual clue, he's really allowing the viewer to start to question the comparator, the distinctness between calligraphy and painting. And the characters were abstracted in different ways, so we see things like that, and say this. This looks like trees, but it's made up entirely of calligraphic strokes. So really the only difference this picture of trees has with a character or say a piece of calligraphy is the way in which these strokes are arranged. And I think there's a move away from this sort of drips and ink washes, which you see in 2006. And there's this more drier, more controlled form of strokes, which I think is really going back towards his earlier practice. His personal style is actually quite hard to get along. And a very important part, we have mentioned color previously, is that he has almost given up on the concept of Liu Bai. Liu Bai is, there's one good example here. Say a piece of painting like this, you get the trees, and he doesn't fill in the background because that's the part of imagination for former Chinese painting practice. It forms part of the composition, it produces tension, it produces distance, stuff like that. But he does away with that. In this piece, he borders it up, he really narrows your view towards that. He gets rid of any sort of distraction from the subject matter as he can. And for that piece, he fills in the entire background with this encircling of color. He really narrows the view of the view and attention of the viewer. And here are some more examples of how he does it. This he creates it with a background of color. This one too. But this one you get a bit more interesting because he starts to produce this sort of calligraphic strokes with color also in the background. And you get items like this. Oh, sorry, that was from 2008. And in the exhibition, he also started to create things like this. So he goes back again to his very, very familiar subject matters. And the same sort of encircling with color, background color. this sort of very strong characteristic strokes, and this abstractness, this move away from the details of the boat. And I think if you look at it the same way as the trees, I think this was he was trying to do something here. He's also expressing the idea that any subject matter in its essence they are really just calligraphic strokes. And these are three Chinese characters in the world. So now we move towards his calligraphy. His period of the common motif during this whole period was really just talking about how to express his idea of calligraphy onto his paintings, right? And I think this period of constant working with his paintings had an effect on his calligraphy as well. Because you can't keep thinking about how to express calligraphy with painting without actually having any new thoughts about your calligraphy, right? So he moves away from the individualness of the characters, the text, the idea of a sentence, what we call hanqi. And he focused on the pulse and rhythm of calligraphy. So the idea about this is, this shows you an idea of calligraphy. It doesn't show you the tradition, the essential aspects of traditional calligraphy. It only showed hints towards this thing being calligraphy. And again, you see this sort of Jingshiwei strokes. And the most important thing, I think, is moving away from the idea of the meaning of text. Because for most calligraphers, they identify with the literary tradition. And it's what you're writing is as important as the way you write it. And in fact, you'll find a lot collectors that focus on calligraphy say that, this is formalistically not so nice, but there's a very strong meaning behind his characters, the way he interacts with how he writes it out, and that puts it a lot above a person who does a very good piece of calligraphy, but let's say he just copies Tang poems. And I think this is a big part of Tze Peng's identity, because even though he was good at Chinese, he was brought up in the literati sort of tradition. He has never written his own poems, he has just copied Tang poems over and over again. And actually, when this sort of things came out, there were a lot of calligraphers who sort of denounced it as not true calligraphy. And this is what Tze Peng would later call intrinsic modern calligraphy. And so in 2009, this exhibition came out, Influence, Xinxia. And Mr. Ko approached Mr. Teo, who was an art commentator and over there curator of this private museum art retreat, to hold an exhibition of this new batch of Tze Peng's new works. And this time it attracted very strong attention, partly because the public has been primed for a number of years towards this new idea of Tze Peng's style, and also because I think there was a greater maturation that the public was not faced with diversity, but with a concentration in his of ideas and a commonly recurring motif in his works. And Fan Dian, who was the director of Amok in Beijing, was extremely impressed with this sort of work, and he brought it to Beijing and Shanghai. And the story is that he had to cancel at last moment exhibition, planned exhibitions of a few Chinese artists in order to stop Tze Peng in such a short notice. So, and if the addition of emails in China, which was held in 2009, in Nanhong in Beijing and Liu Haisu Museum in Shanghai, has a greater wall space. So you can just compare the publications of Singapore and China you can sort of tell. And the effect of this was that there's more calligraphy that was shown. And I think this was very important in showing the sort of advances that's been made in calligraphy. And, well, when I wrote this statement, if you ask me to pin a point where Tze Peng's calligraphy took a very strong turn, I would say this. But more recently, I have begun to think it's this sort of period, this two words over here, flanking the centerpiece, which is apart from 2000 batch of the year 2000 to 2002-ish, where he walked into space owned by two of his friends, artist friends, and he saw these large spaces, large pieces of paper, and he just asked people to do some calligraphy on it, and this was what happened. It was very one-off thing, well not one-off, a few or three or four-off things that produces this sort of very interesting characters. Say this one, it's... anyone wants to hazard a guess what Chinese character this is? What if I tell you it's upside down? It's a zhong. You know, loyalty zhong. So it's something upside down. And the other one at the back, it's done with one stroke. So he was experimenting with things like that. And if you compare it with later on in 2006, he reverts a bit to this calligraphy. I think he was not very sure with himself. But so I think this time allowed him greater exposure to his calligraphy. But I think this is where he really first begins to show this sort of idea. So during the time, during this whole time, the art world has really been paying attention to his paintings. Because everyone was just really shocked that this 90-year-old man produce paintings of such size, such breadth, such charisma, and that was formed the main part of his acclaim. But during that exhibition and slightly after, there's slightly more attention put towards his calligraphy, which I would argue has always shown this very strong change. Whatever aesthetic ideas Tze Peng has put on his paintings, also in his calligraphy, but just as less shown. More subtly, it was, and formalistically, it's this application of decisively and movement into his calligraphy. And although they were always shown in exhibitions, they were always sort of like appendix. So let's say this 2006 exhibition is only at the end when you get some idea of his calligraphy. Same for this 2003, which is quite odd seeing that he always talks about how he was a calligrapher first and foremost. And at this time, there was still monochrome. Then we get faced with this sort of calligraphy. Well, the story goes that once Tze Peng was painting his large paintings, and there was a lot of heavy use of color now, and the colors seep through his paper into a whole stack of paper, and he took off the paper and he's like, oh, this color background looks pretty good, and he did some calligraphy onto it. So this is the story of how he first started to use color. And this provoked this this idea of using color fields and color to disturb the